before the watches of the night. Hear my voice according to your steadfast love. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Call upon me in the day of trouble. Merciful ears, be attentive to the prayers of your servants, and by your word and spirit, teach us how to pray, that our petitions may be pleasing before you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading for the seventh Sunday after Pentecost is taken from Genesis chapter 18. The Lord said, "Shall I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do, seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall bless him? For I have chosen..." the book flipped back a page. Then the Lord said, "Because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and their sins very grave, I will go down and see what they have done altogether, according to the outcry that has come to me. And if not, I will know." So the men turned from there and went towards Sodom. But Abraham still stood before the Lord. Then Abraham drew near and said, Will you indeed sweep away the righteous with the wicked? Suppose there are 50 righteous within the city. Will you then sweep away the place and not spare it for the 50 righteous who are in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to put the righteous to death with the wicked, so that the righteous fare as the wicked. Far be that from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is just? And the Lord said, If I find at Sodom 50 righteous in the city, I will spare the whole place for their sake. Abraham answered and said, Behold, I have undertaken to speak to the Lord, I who am but dust and ashes. Suppose 5 of the 50 righteous are lacking. Will you destroy the whole city for lack of 5? And he said, I will not destroy it if I find 45 there. Again he spoke to him and said, Suppose 40 are found there. He answered, For the sake of 40, I will not do it. Then he said, Oh, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak. Suppose 30 are found there. He answered, I will not do it if I find 30 there. He said, Behold, I have undertaken to speak to the Lord. Suppose 20 are found there. He answered, For the sake of 20, I will not destroy it. Then he said, Let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak again, but this once. Suppose 10 are found there. He answered, For the sake of 10, I will not destroy it. And the Lord went his way when he had finished speaking to Abraham, and Abraham returned to his place. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from Colossians chapter 2. Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and you have been filled in him, who is the head of all rule and authority. In him also you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith, in the powerful working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you, who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. Therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food and drink, or with regard to festival or new moon or a Sabbath. These are a shadow of the things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Let no one disqualify you insisting on asceticism and worship of angels, going in detail about visions, puffed up without reason by his sensuous mind, and not holding fast to the head from whom the whole body, nourished and knit together through its joints and ligaments, grows with a growth that is from God. This is the word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 11th chapter. Now Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples. And he said to them, When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. For we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us, and lead us not into temptation. And he said to them, Which of you has a friend will go to him at midnight and say to him, Friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine has arrived on a journey, and I have nothing to set before him. And he will answer from within, don't bother me. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impudence, he will rise and give him whatever he needs. And I tell you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, it will be opened. What father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Here endeth the gospel. Children may come forward for the children's choir. Thank you. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus, like all good teachers, teaches his disciples in many and various ways. He teaches them in word, and he teaches them in deed. Our Lord Jesus was not the sort to say, "Do as I say, not as I do." No, indeed, he always leads by example. One way to judge the measure of a man is whether his life accords with the principles that he holds, in private and in public. Is he the sort of man that he says he is? When it comes to Jesus, his words always accord with his actions. He is the man he says he is. With our Lord, what you see is what you get. He says, "Follow me, go and do likewise," and so he is our example, whom we follow and emulate. Thus St. Paul exhorts us, "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ." Christ teaches his disciples by way of his example, by rigorous instruction, and with parables. And in our text this morning, we see all three. This morning, we will start with Jesus' example. He himself was a man of prayer. Our text begins, "Now Jesus was praying in a certain place." This was not the first time his disciples had seen him pray. The evangelist Luke pays particular attention to those times when Jesus steps aside from the crowds and the masses to pray according to his custom. And in this, in his example, we already have our two first lessons about prayer. Prayer should be a habit or custom of our lives. It should be a habit or custom in the sense that we should pray frequently. It may be true that there is no atheist in a foxhole, for prayer is not only for those desperate times when we call out for God, asking for help and mercy. It is part of our daily life. We should daily give thanks to God for all his good gifts to us, and we should daily ask him for the things we need, for he daily gives us our daily bread. We sin daily and are sinned against daily. And so every day we should pray, "Forgive us our sins, as we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us." We need God's constant forgiveness, and we must pray for the strength to forgive others, for those who have sinned against us. For if we do not forgive those who sin against us, we would constantly be living in a situation where we are rent asunder, divided, and with hatred towards one another and animosities. Our families, our church, and our society would be in this state. We speak often about the coarsening political discourse in our country, the division between right and left. How much of this division is caused by our inability to forgive past wrongs or present wrongs? We need to pray daily because temptation comes to us daily. The world and our own sinful nature that still clings to us tempts us and deceives us every minute. We must pray to our Heavenly Father that he would lead us out of this temptation. And finally, we should pray that he deliver us from evil. In summary, we should daily come to God as dear children come to their dear Father, because our whole life depends on him. Second, prayer should be a habit or custom in the sense that we do it without second thought, namely, that we pray because we are about to eat, and that's what we always do. We should pray when our heart is in it and when it is not in it. We should pray when we feel the need to pray, and also when we're tired, about to lie down for bed, when we don't really have anything in particular on our mind, simply because it is our custom to pray before bed. Theologically speaking, a habit is a stable disposition of the soul. When you form a habit of prayer, that communication with God, that reliance upon him, becomes your orientation. It becomes the disposition of your own soul. If we only pray when we feel like we need to pray, we won't do it very often. And when we do need to pray, we won't do it because we aren't accustomed to it. But if we pray according to custom, it practices us in prayer. And when we need to pray, we will naturally pray. We are in the practice and custom of bringing things before God in prayer. Your heart will naturally yearn to bring those troubles before God because that is what you have trained yourself to do. And you'll have the words to pray, whether they come directly from your heart or from one of the written prayers you are used to saying. A simple, "Lord, have mercy," is enough in desperate times. God knows your need. Now, from Jesus' example, the disciples are spurred to ask him about prayer. And he gives them specific instructions on how to pray and what to say. And he teaches them about prayer through two parables. For the sake of time, we'll skip past the prayer itself and move into the parables directly. Both these parables teach us about how God hears our prayers and how he responds. The point of each is to give us confidence to pray, to assure us of God's heart toward us, that he hears our cries and he responds in just the way we need. In the first parable, we have a man who has an unexpected and unannounced visitor who comes to him at night from far off. The ancients understood far better than we do that friendship comes with a reciprocal set of duties and obligations. And so this man, according to the ancient customs of friendship and hospitality, was obligated to take this unexpected guest into his home and provide a meal for him. But since the visit was unexpected, he had no bread on hand to lay before his visitor. So off he goes into the night to call upon one of his own friends. His own friend is asleep and in bed with his children. And let us note what a burden this simple request for bread will be. It was typical in the first century for a family to all share one bed, to sleep together in one bed. And if you recall from last week, their house was probably only one room, and this room was locked by a door with a very heavy bolt. To unbolt it will create no small noise. For the man to get up, to loose the bolt, to get the bread, and answer the door, it is assured that he will wake up his children. For all of you who have children, just imagine waking up a whole clutch of them at midnight and trying to get them all settled back down in one bed. The friend's response is understandable. Groggy and tired, facing the prospect of a bedtime apocalypse, he would want to say, "Do not bother me. The door is now shut. My children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything." And yet, ultimately, what will the response be? Jesus says, "I tell you, though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impudence, he will rise and give him whatever he needs." At that moment, the friend won't give the man what he needs out of the kindness of his heart. How kind do you feel when you're woken up at midnight? And yet, bound by duty and by the impudence of the request, he will give the man everything he needs. When we approach our earthly friend, he'll grudgingly give us what we need, and so it is when we approach God. Except God is a better friend than the man at home with his children. This is one of those God is like, but greater parables. We are indeed like the man, to come to God in prayer even when it seems impudent. And prayer often does seem impudent. Why should God be concerned about our petty needs? He's busy governing the universe, right? He has bigger things to worry about. And yet he does care about our concerns. And God is our friend. For Jesus says, "Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. I have called you friends. For you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you, that you should go and bear fruit, that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. Before the foundation of the world, you have been chosen, elected to be redeemed by Christ, to be covered with his blood, and to receive his righteousness. God has already given you all things. Christ has died for you and made you his friend. God has given you his son and sonship. He has given you grace and life. Thus, we should not fear to bring our prayers before him. If he has freely given us so much, how much more is he willing to give? The friend in the parable will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impudence. But God is a better friend than that. Jesus says of the Father, he will answer your prayer because the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. God does not sleep. God will hear your prayer and he will answer your prayer, not simply out of duty, like the friend in the parable, although he has bound himself to you with the promises of holy baptism, but he will answer in love, because he loves you for Jesus' sake. And so we should take confidence and ask and know that it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. Of course, that does not mean if you pray for a Ferrari, God is going to give you a Ferrari. Jesus is speaking about those prayers that are offered up according to God's will. That is, he is speaking about the Lord's Prayer as our example, that God's name be hallowed, that his kingdom come, that he give us our daily bread, and that he forgives us and gives us the strength to forgive those who have sinned against us, that he would lead us not into temptation. To these things, God answers yes. Now, the second parable is like the first. What father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? If our earthly fathers know how to take care of their children, how much more is it true of our Heavenly Father who loves us with perfect love? He will not give us something that'll harm us, and so we do not need to fear that we pray for the wrong things. He will not give you a scorpion or a serpent. This is especially true when we pray for the one thing needful, for the gift of the Holy Spirit, that he would give us his Holy Spirit, that we might cling to Jesus in faith. So let us heed Jesus' example, and let us heed Jesus' teaching. Let us pray, and let us pray often. Let us pray on Sunday morning, and on weekday mornings as well. Let us pray when we rise, and when we lie down to sleep. Let us pray when we are in desperate need, and when we sit down for our daily meal. Christ has died for you. He has made God your friend, and he has made God your Father, and he has made you God's children. Our Lord bids us to pray, and he hears, and he answers. Let us pray for our daily bread, and let us pray that God's kingdom might come to us, that he send his Holy Spirit into our hearts, so that we may focus always on the one thing needful, Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, and who is our resurrection and life. Amen. You may rise for the offertory.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, your Son has taught us to pray that your name would be hallowed and your kingdom come, and for all our needs of body and soul, grant us trusting hearts that turn to you in all joy and sorrow, finding in your fatherly goodness and will all that we ask, seek, need, or desire. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, your righteous Son intercedes on behalf of sinners before your throne. When the outcry of our sin troubles us, grant faithful pastors to speak your word of warning and comfort, that we may be drawn in repentance to his cross and seek shelter in his mercy and so escape destruction. Let this message be proclaimed in Macau through your servant David and his wife Barbara. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Father, you have given all rule and authority to Jesus Christ our Lord. May our homes be permeated by your word, that all families may dwell in the light of your Son. Grant your Holy Spirit to husbands and wives, parents and children, young and old, and all who live alone, that we may not be taken captive by the spirit of the world, but rather built up into him who is the head. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of hosts, you judge the sinful deeds of man in righteousness. Grant us civil leaders who will serve in accordance with your will, condemning what is evil and approving what is good. We especially pray for Joe, our president, and Mike, our governor. May all nations be brought to see the wisdom and glory of your Son and dwell together in peace and humility. Also bless Sean, Austin, and Thomas, as they serve to protect our nation. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Father, you give good gifts to your children. Grant your Holy Spirit to Harold, Esther, Marvin, Mary, Jim, Pam, Aubrey, Barbara, Charlotte, Maya, Wanda, Kenny, Patricia, and all those who suffer in body, mind, and soul, that confident in your mercy, they may look to you for comfort and peace in their afflictions. Grant them healing according to your will and patience to bear their crosses. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing and look to you as the giver of all good gifts. Make us ever eager to come to you in prayer and thanksgiving, as your Son has taught us. By your Holy Spirit, bring us to behold in Christ the fulfillment of those things for which we pray, your holy name, your kingdom, daily bread, forgiveness, shelter in temptation, and deliverance from every evil. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Blessed Lord, who has caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may in such wise hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of thy holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which thou hast given us in Jesus Christ our Savior, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.